那这个失败了以后，又有一个新的转变，这个转变就是大家转去讨论说如何保护儿童，用保护儿童，前面是保护女人，现在保护儿童，用保护儿童的方式来进行言论的检查和网络的检查。那我们需要来学习的前车之鉴，因为在过去的女性主义性辩论当中已经看到了用保护女人为名所进行的言论检查是有非常非常大的问题，而常常沦入保守的阵营当中。所以我们需要用这个当中也开始来学习到性言论其实并不等于有害言论，我们不要认为所有跟性相关的事情都是有害的事情。性言论其实跟政治言论跟一般的社会言论是一样的，大家都是假设政治讨论是无害的，假设我们对于社会里面所讲的这些言论都是无害的，而性的言论特别有害，那这样一个假设是有问题的。因为我们必须要看到在这样的一个假设之后，其实正是展露了我们的文化对于性就先假设性是不好的事情，这里有一个歧视的基础，先有了这个对于性的歧视，后来所得出来所有的结论都会认为性的言论是有害的。我们必须要视性言论作为一种政治言论，这也是刚才卡维波在讲，一直强调的，性言论是一种政治言论，而作为政治言论，它并没有特别的天生就是有害。相反的，我们要用政治言论，不一样的政治言论，不同的意见的讨论来看待它们。
The second point is that arguments about protecting children, like arguments about protecting women, are a Trojan horse. That is, they seem to be something that they are not. Their appeal is that they sound very normal and very sympathetic, but their goal is to bring aboutgreater repression with less justification, because sex is so feared and stigmatized in both our societies. Our brains take a vacation when people make arguments based on sex, and we let the censorship slip past us when it is labeled protecting the innocence of the young, when reallywhat it is on the inside and what it will do once it gets out in the society is to repress all of us and to repress all of our freedoms. So when we hear this kind of argument being made, we have to say, stop, think about this, use your brain. This should be the point that you use.In thinking about and discussing these questions.
所谓的保护主义的说法其实是一种声东击西的做法，就听起来很正常，很善意，很关怀，很保护，可是事实上它的目的的话是因为就是没什么好理由，可是要压迫你，没什么理由就是要压迫你，但是怎么样能够使这种不合理的做法能够合理化呢？就是使用大家最常见的成见。那由于在这个文化里面，性本来就是一个很污名化的题目，大家一提到以后就觉得不好意思，或觉得它是不好的东西，或者心里面有所不安，因此你就完全没有想到说，哎，这个事情其实是对我的言论的检查，对我自由的侵犯。所以我一听到说性的东西对孩子不好，我们大家就好像就放弃了我们原先的理性思考的能力，而就跟上去搭上去说，对对对对，要保护儿童，我们应该检验这个言论。因此奈奈这里建议说，我们需要认识到这种保护言论常常到最后变成了压迫了所有人的自由。我们听到大家用的保护之词的时候，一定要有抗拒，说，哎，对不起，停下来，让我们好好想想看，我们这到底在保护什么东西，我们到底限制了什么东西。我们需要有那个思考的空间，而不是很轻易的就落入这种否定的认为性不好的那样一个成见的范围。
And last point I want to make is that the real issue is not harm to children when it is used as the basis for these broadly repressive laws. It is control. It is control of women, control of children, control of power within the family. And laws like this will not really ultimately silence sexual speech, but they will silence debate.They will have the effect not of eliminating sexual speech, but of repressing political speech. And that is something that we should all be very dedicated to preventing. So that if there is a rule that the internet and access to the internet should contain only what is supposedly safe for children, it is like saying that our library should contain only children's books. And we cannot let that happen to the internet, just as we would not let that happen to our great university and public libraries. Thank you very much.
我们要认识到那种所谓对儿童有害的这样的说法，其实不是真正的这些法律设定的目标。这个法律真正设定目标是要控制，是要控制女人，控制小孩，控制在家庭里面的权利，控制谁可以决定谁可以看什么电视，谁可以看什么录影带，谁可以上什么样的网络的网站网页。这样子的一些严厉的控制措施，其实并不会真的很成功的禁止性资讯、性言论的扩散。他们所做的事情，只是使得大家没有空间去辩论，使得辩论晋升，因为大家想到说，哎，这个题目大概不好辩论，或者不好讲，或者讲了以后会被人家问到我自己的状况是怎么样，那就会使得大家不想要辩论这个题目，躲避这样的一个麻烦。因此到最后的话，就是使得性言论作为一种政治言论也完全承袭下来。那我们必须要认识到说，这种所谓把我们的网络弄得很清洁，让孩子们可以很安全的在里面遨游，这种说法的话，就等于说要求把我们图书馆里面很多很多书都搬掉，很多很多书都去除，有很多我们大家启蒙的看的书，像《金瓶梅》啊，都要被除掉。那过去在美国有一个很蓬勃的运动，就是有一些家长要求在图书馆里面很多很多书都被拿掉，包括他们的那个《汤姆历险记》都要拿掉。那这个东西已经被进步人士挡住了，因此他也希望我们不要让同样的这种消除禁止言消除可疑言论的这种作为发生在有关于网络的这样一个伟大的空间当中。谢谢大家。
Thank you. I want to take a step back a bit and not discuss the internet per se, but to actually begin to look at what we might call the construction of innocence in the culture. Before I begin, I want to make three small provisos. One is that being an American and a Westerner, many of the examples I'm going to use, I think you'll probably know, but they are from Western culture. The second thing is that, although I will talk about the idea that children and some women who we might call the good women are seen as being innocent, I don't want to imply that, in fact, in many, many ways, both children and women are at a disadvantage in a male-dominated society. And thirdly, when I use the word heterosexual sort of freely, which I do not mean men and women who are having sex with one another, but rather what feminists have called institutionalized heterosexuality, which is the institution of heterosexuality, which I think people here would understand. I just wanted to make that clear. There is a generally accepted idea that this notion of innocence actually exists, and that we actually see it most prevalently in children and in what I referred to before in this good women, as opposed to all those bad women. And I think it's important to actually realize that this is while in fact there's always been the oppression of women throughout history, that took various forms, this notion of innocence is actually a fairly new concept, probably dating, at least in the West, from the mid-19th century, during the reign of Queen Victoria. It's important to think about that even in, say, the Middle Ages, that the Catholic Church, lovely building we're in here now, when they banned books such as Chaucer's great poem, The Canterbury Tales, it was not banned for its very explicit sexuality, but rather because it made fun of nuns and priests. So up until Victorian times, there was actually a very different attitude about sexuality and about innocence. So what do we mean when we talk about this sort of innocence? It's generally defined as a disinterest in or a rejection of sexuality. Then that is at heart that it's based upon the false idea that ignorance about sexuality or sexual experience is actually a good thing, and it's even a natural state that exists in nature or by itself. Because we all know that both children, neither children nor good women, wouldn't want to know about sex at all. This is obviously wrong for two reasons, or maybe more, but I have two. It's a circular argument. It presumes that ignorance and lack of sexuality actually equals innocence, so it actually refers back to itself. And secondly, it's just plain wrong that women and children do have sexual desires and can act on them. So this cultural idea of sort of innocence is in fact constructed, and the question I want to raise is by whom and for what, or we might ask who actually benefits from this.
今天晚上 Michael 最主要的想要谈到就是我们文化当中是怎么样去建构所谓天真无邪无欲的这种状态。那他要先说明一下，说他今天举的例子，因为他比较熟悉美国的文化，所以第一个他所举的例子都会是从美国来的。第二个，当他在讲孩子或者我们一般所讲的那种好女人都是很清纯的很天真无邪的话，那这个意思并不代表说他们在这个文化当中是弱势，并不代表他们在一个男性主导文化当中一定是弱势。第三个就是他也会提到所谓异性恋，不过他所说的异性恋并不是说男人女人性关系这叫异性恋，他要指的是这个体制，这是一个独特独霸权力的这个异性恋体制。下面的话，他认为一般人是常常讲说这个天真无邪这种清纯的状态好像是一个自然的存在，比方说最常看到的就是小孩啊，或者小说里面那种好女人啊，或者我们在媒体当中看到那种玉女啊之类的这种好女人。可是像这样的一个所谓认为清纯就是天然存在的这个状态啊，其实是一个蛮新的比较近代的一个说法。因为比方说像中世纪的时候，天主教教会当时也有禁书的动作，那个我们英国文学史上最出名的 Chaucer 的这个长篇的诗作 Canterbury Tales 就被禁掉。可是他们禁的原因倒不是因为是 Canterbury 里面这个 Tales 里面有很多很多的色情场面，不是因为这个，而是因为这个诗里面取笑了天主教的教士。所以大家可以看得到说，其实在中世纪的时候，他们对于什么是清纯，什么是这个天真无邪，其实有跟现代不太一样的说法。直到比较近代的时候，开始建立起来说，哎，其实小孩子是靠近大自然，是有纯真的状态，是这个无欲的状态，才建立起来。而且很有趣的是说，近代所建立的这个所谓 innocence 就是无欲、纯真、天真无邪这样一个概念哦，基本上讲的是说，对于性无知，对于性无经验。很奇怪的一种天真纯洁啊，就是他这个天真纯洁其实是无知而已，而且大家认为说那样子的一个无知的状态，没有经验的状态是一个好事情，是一个天然的状态，是很自然的东西，然后好像天然的小孩和好女人都不想要知道有关于性的事情，他们都不希望跟有性的事情发生任何的关联。那这样一个做法，这样一个说法其实是完全不正确的，因为第一个，为什么无知就等于天真？无知就等于清纯，无知就等于无欲呢？第二个，它上面那个说法的话，其实根本是错误的，因为女人和小孩都有欲望，好女人和小孩都有欲望，而且他们都寻找自己的方式来满足这些欲望。因此，我们就必须要开始问这个问题，就是既然他们的欲望存在，既然这也不是一个天然的状态，那我们就要问，那么清纯这个概念，天真无邪这个概念，无欲这个概念到底是怎么被建构出来的，是为谁的利益而建构，为什么而建构，是谁在做这个事情，谁在建构这个事情。
So the question of who has constructed this and who benefits, the answer is generally speaking heterosexual men and a gendered heterosexual cultural norm that we all generally live under. I have already said that the idea of innocence is nothing more than a glorification of ignorance. And of course, we have seen over the past 20, 25 years in the new gender theory, in queer theory, in post-colonial theory, that ruling classes, be they men, heterosexuals, or imperialists, nationalists maintain their control through promoting ignorance. If women and children are innocent, they need to be unaware of the material world, and they need to be protected. That's the basis for the claim that they're innocent. And this protection takes the form of being watched, being patrolled, being spied upon, and if necessary, being punished when they refuse to act in the innocent manner which has been ascribed to them. So I think that we can see that innocence is in reality simply another form of sexual regulation. This time promoted not in the name of again, I can't do this, for their own good, but as a maintenance of a so-called natural order.
因此，如果我们要问这样子一个清纯的概念是被谁建构的呢？那我们说的比较清楚一点的话，就是被异性恋男人。我听清楚了，他刚刚讲的异性恋，不是说那个跟女人发生关系的异性恋，就是属于这个体制掌权的这个体制，异性恋男人以及所谓的性别规范体制，这样一个性别规范体制在创造清纯的这个概念的时候，其实最重要的所做的事情就是。 歌颂无知，无知是件好事，无知是一件大家都应，就是特别是小孩和女人应该表现的。所以这种把无知当成一种非常崇高的这个价值观来宣传，在过去已经受到了新的性别理论、后殖民理论、酷儿理论、同志理论的这个攻击，因为这一些新的理论都已经显示，掌权阶级往往在维系他自己的控制的权力的时候，就是透过。 希望能够让大家都维持在无知的状态，因为无知才会让他们认所欲为。因此，在保护言论当中，就常常会说女人和小孩应该被保护，不要接近现实世界，不要接近我们真正的人类的这个真正的现实。我们要保护他们。可是我们仔细去看什么是保护的时候，我们发觉保护叫做事实上所进行的活动就是监控，随时巡逻，随时打开你的门看看你在干嘛，偷看。 偷看你的信，偷看你的电话，偷看你的 email， 甚至在你做出不合他要求的时候进行惩罚。所以保护其实后面所带过来的是一连串的非常严厉的权力措施。而所谓的清纯，所谓的天真无邪，到最后只是变成了社会的一种强烈的规范，而且这个规范还是假借了说我是为你好啊那种名义来进行的，要。
I think it was the Carol Vance, a feminist in America, who said in the early 80s, when I hear the word protected, I know that what's really going on is about power and control. And I think for the most part, the argument about innocence and protection are simply covers for the larger project of sexual domination. It's simply a false argument that is meant to maintain the sexual control of women and children by maintaining the falsehood that they have no sexuality. I think a very good example of this is in Victorian England, which highly prized the notion of innocence in their writing and in their social policies. And as we know now, as they knew then, that in fact Victorian England was rife with horrible examples of child labor and children died working in factories and in mines. It was rife with prostitution. Stephen Marcus, in his book called The Other Victorian, claims that every seventh house in London was some form of a brothel, and that a third of those were for underage girls. So much for innocence and for protection. Think protection and innocence are usually covers for the exact opposite. That is, that women and children are, in fact, presumed to have an uncontrollable sexual urge, that they are always in danger of becoming out of control. And this, of course, is as much of a lie as the lie that they are, in fact, innocent.
在美国性辩论当中很著名的这个支持色情、支持女性情欲的一个作家，那 Carol Vance， 他就常常讲说，他说，我只要听到保护这两个字，我就会想到权力和控制，因为往往保护的言辞所掩盖的是性压迫、性宰制。当我们控制女人和小孩，假装他们没有任何的性的欲望的时候，举一个例子，就像维多利亚时代。 所有的小说里面，所有的写作当中，都在讴歌女人的这种清纯状态，小孩的清纯状态。可是现实的世界当中，当时却是儿童的童工受到无尽的压迫的，很剥削的这个时代。当时也是各式各样的卖淫的行为，到处都是的这个状态。当时还有一位非常重要的研究维多利亚时代的这个作者。 Stephen Marcus 还在他的研究里面指出来说，当时几乎每七家，其实就有一家是有某一种卖淫的行为的进行，就像是禁锢一样。那因此，事实上，19世纪高歌的这样一个清纯的无欲的这种状态，这种保护的这种言论，它的底下所掩盖的恰恰是相反，而且他们常常所使用的那个言论的话。 这个保护主义之后翻开来的话，其实他们还有一种忧心，这个忧心就是认为小孩和女人有某种那种不可控制的、强大的、狂野的情欲，所以很担心他们如果没有得到适当的保护和教养的话，那这种情欲就会一发不可收拾的野火燎原，所以一定要对他们进行非常非常严密的控制。
The idea of the sexual or the evil woman, as particularly the prostitute we've seen often enough, is being demonized within culture, and the seductive child runs throughout the imagination. I'm thinking of, particularly in the case of children, if we think about in the 1970s when we actually had the beginning of these campaigns to protect children, there was a rash of Hollywood movies, probably 10 or 15 of them, beginning with The Exorcist, which in fact, at the same time with we had enormous cultural discourse about protecting children, the most popular movies were those actually that showed children not only to be bad, but in fact the devil, the ultimate naughty child. So this sort of coexists at the same time, the sort of construction of innocence and then the construction of the monster. And I think this is a detail which we haven't discussed here, but that in fact is very, very much the byproduct of the construction of innocence, which is the construction of the sexual monster, which we've seen repeatedly and I can speak with some Western examples, in the homosexual, in the black rapist in American culture. And even in American culture, there is in the late 18th, early 19th century, a very, very strong myth about Chinese men being sexual predators preying on young white women in the West. This was because of the large amounts of Chinese immigration to California to help build the railroads, or actually to make them build the railroads, since it was not help. And in all these examples, what happened was that the notion of innocence was then used to demonize minority groups, be they gay men or black men, who were presumed to actually be crazed and sexually drawn to raping white women in the South, or Asian men. There's actually, I don't know if people can get a copy of here, a 1918 movie by D.W. Griffith, who made Birth of a Nation, called Broken Blossoms, about a Chinese man who is accused of sexually assaulting a white woman. And it's quite interesting. He's played by a white actor because it is 1918 in Hollywood. But I think that that's an example, that's a side product, or maybe a major product of the construction of innocence, which is that it's actually used, again, not only for the social control of women and children, but the social control of anybody who doesn't fit into the heterosexual norm, which includes race as well as sexual activity.
上一段结尾的时候，我们有谈到说，当时这个保护的这种言论的话，事实上底下掩盖的却是对于充满性欲的女人以及那种充满诱惑力的孩子的一种恐惧。所以事实上，在保护言论非常强大、强力的蔓延的同时的话，事实上也有一种对于这两种人的这个恐惧也同时在蔓延。再举一个例子，像1970年代的时候，将这个保护儿童这种言论刚刚在兴起的时候。当时好莱坞就拍了一系列的片子，当时最流行的片子就是大家可能看过《大法师》，就那里面的那个女主角年纪很小，可是充满了诱惑力，讲一嘴那个脏话的。如果没看的话，真的要去看一下那个是一个里程碑的。哎，当时很有趣，就是一方面在公共言论当中保护儿童的言论，把儿童描绘成非常的清纯、天真无邪，可是同时的话，好莱坞片里面所描述的这个。儿童的话却是非常非常坏，非常非常邪恶，甚至像大法师里面这个女孩子，她本身就是魔鬼。所以，在这个保护言论起的同时的话，也开始有一些描述这个有性欲的女人或者这种有吸引力的孩子是很可怕的。同时还有另外一种所谓的性怪兽啊，这种性的怪兽的话，就包含比较多的看到的例子都是像同性恋啊。黑人强奸犯啊，大家听到这两个例子就会知道中间的那个连结就是性欲很强的意思。同性恋啊，到处乱找人啊，黑人强奸犯啊，看到白人就要强奸啊，甚至他还举一个很有趣的例子，我们可能还比较不太熟悉，就是在美国早期修建铁路的时候，因为从中国唐山进口了很多这个中国奴工，当时也在那个他们早期的那个电影，像1918年的一个电影啊，在那当中就描述中国男人是性欲很强的。我们几十遍的是的，当时我们认为中国男人性欲很强啊，因为都是到处要找白女人，伤害白女人。那从这些例子，其实可以很清楚的看得出来，所谓的保护言论，这种把清纯加在女人身上、加在儿童身上的时候，它不单单是控制了这一些女人和小孩。另一方面，它也使得少数群体妖魔化，也就是说，同性恋啦、黑人啦、中国人啦，任何这些不属于白人异性恋体制的这个正规的想象的男人应该有的样子的，只要是不符合这个性别体制的这些所谓种族上面或者性取向上面的这个少数的话，都要在同样的这样子一个清纯言论当中被妖魔化。
So I think that we can see that the project here is not actually protecting children from homosexuals, it's attacking homosexuals. It's not protecting white women in the South from black men, it's attacking black men, and it's not protecting young white girls from Asian men, it's in fact attacking Asian men. But I think that to move from here, that it's not just enough to actually expose or critique the language that goes into protection and innocence, but to find ways to get rid of those constructs. And just as feminism, and as Nan was speaking about before, women speaking for themselves and defining what they need, and lesbians and gay men doing that as well, we also need to actively promote a multitude of ways that we can find to empower children to have their own lives so that they are no longer the excuse for attacking other people. I think that's very difficult because children in the culture have become emblematic of an innocence which doesn't really exist. And that's a very difficult myth to get away from. I mean, what would it mean if we actually decided to give childrenmore money and the power over their money, or we gave them more license for sexuality or more freedoms. I think most people hopefully are not particularly prepared to do that. And it's scary. As somebody who lived in the early 70s in a commune where we tried to do this, it was very exciting and very scary because several times we were outvoted at house meetings by the children. And that was something we had to deal with. So I would just say that a project as large as feminism and as large as getting rid of race discriminations, ethnic discriminations, and feminism is to find ways to treat children as human beings. And until we're able to actually look at all of the varied sexual desires of children and of women, and look at honestly the desires of women and men who are adults, only when we do that openly can we be prepared to move on to a more sophisticated and humane and hopefully healthy view of social and political power. Thank you.
从上面这个例子，其实我们可以看得出来，所谓的保护女人和小孩免受于同志或者黑人或我们中国人、亚洲人的伤害，事实上所做的事情是真正是在攻击同志、攻击黑人、攻击亚洲人、攻击我们中国人、台湾人，我们 whatever。也就是说，保护言论到最后其实不是只保护而已，它其实是很积极的攻击性少数、种族少数。因此他也认为我们不能够只是简简单单是批评这样的一个保护言论，他觉得批评不够，他觉得我们还要更积极的去对抗所谓 innocence， 所谓无欲无知、天真无邪这样子的一个文化建构，我们要对抗这些建构。因此他认为同志、性少数或者对于性权有兴趣的人都需要开始去思考，创造很多种不同的方法来使得女人、使得小孩有更大的权利来拥有他们自己的生活。当然这个做法会有点困难，原因是说在我们文化当中一贯的文化建构就是把小孩描绘成没有理性啊、心智不够成熟啊、或者无力抗拒啊、或者没有什么章法啦、这不听话啦什么这种形象。所以有的时候我们想到说是不是要给小孩子更多一点钱啊，而且他们可以掌控他们自己的钱，或者我们让他们有跟性的生活开始有一些接触，好像大家都会觉得有点小小的不安。那70年代他们在一群的朋友住在公社里面的时候，也曾经尝试过要进行这样的一个让孩子得到权利的做法，就使得这个公社里面所有的孩子都跟大人一样平权。那当时他们的经验就是常常在投票的时候孩子会赢，因为他们人数比较多，比较团结。所以也许在这个时候就正好是一个让大家开始面对到底平权是什么样含义的机会。因此他认为不管是女性主义也好，同志社群也好，性权主义分子，希望我们这边都是性权主义分子，我们都开始去思考怎么样能够对抗像这样子一个清纯的文化建构，怎么样能够把孩子当成有完整的人来对待。这样的一个做法其实有个先决的条件，先决条件就是当我们这些成人都能够非常公开的、非常自然的、正面的来面对性欲望的时候，我们才可能有这样一个成熟的空间来面对孩子作为一个性主体，我们才可能有一个很成熟很健康的社会来行使我们各式各样的社会和政治权利。谢谢。现在从翻译回到主席的位置。我们希望今天四位讲者的话给各位带来了一些刺激大家思考的空间。那我们的时间啊还有1小时15分钟，我们预备10点钟结束。1小时15分钟时间，如果你想要讲什么话的话，今天最好，因为我告诉你啊，明天的国际论坛因为场子很大，要讲话很难，就你应该把握机会，那个距离很短的时候，然后人很少的时候，胆子大一点的时候，赶快有什么话想讲，有什么问题想问，你就直接上。我们下面有一个麦克风，好，前面先。
大家好，我是布斯哈。那我想请教那个 Nan 跟 Michael， 因为你们好像都从纽约来的嘛哈。那我一个很大的好奇是说，在纽约那个地方，因为前一阵子我又看到一个亚裔的研究生，然后他做了一个学术方面的一个研究哈，他突然发现到说，很多那个亚裔的 gay 啊，到了纽约之后，他们要找的对象几乎都是找所谓的西方的白人啊。那这个给我一个很大的一个想法啊。那我想要知道，就是像 Nan 是一个律师嘛，那在处理的过程当中，像 Michael 你在 在那个平权的运动当中，像这个性权的一些的演变的过程当中，种族这个问题，特别是落实在亚裔的这个种族的方面的时候，会不会是这个种族问题是不是会成为这一些，比如说亚裔人口在享受所谓的性权方面一个蛮关键的，也就是说，身为一个亚裔的人口，他在享受这个性权的时候，在纽约那个地方，可能因为这个种族而受到一个蛮关键的一个影响，这是我的一个问题。
你要不要讲得更具体一点，什么个影响？
啊，比如说，啊，因为我是亚裔的，所以在性权方面我就少了什么？那因为我是中产的白人，而且是一个男的啊，那一样是同性恋，那就可能这个种族问题成为一个关键的问题，可能在某一方在法律层面他会受到歧视啊，比较明显的这样子一个歧视。因为我发现到那个研究哈，当亚裔人口。亚裔的 gay 不管是台湾的、日本的、泰国的、马来西亚的，到了纽约一律都是找白的、中产的、白的这个男性的话，这个是不是在这个权力的方面，是因为本身是比较弱势，所以他们必须依靠一个中产的白人的一个同性恋者，使得他们在这方面权力可能是比较获得多一点的保障，这是我一个比较好奇的问题，谢谢。